pretty good friends, I think. I got in this band and was able to stay, so must be all right. You know, if you follow Philip Joe Jones in the band, you know, that's rough. So, well, we got along pretty good. And I, like I said, I used to come around and get him, and I used to do things for him. He used to call me 3 o'clock in the morning, tell me to come get him somewhere. And I'd do that to him too, you know, so because we was that tight. So I'm glad this happened, you know, because it was supposed to happen. Because he's a good guy, and he was always good with me. So all I can say is I'm really happy this happened to him, and it should have happened soon.
This is wonderful. I'm so glad this is happening. I think today Miles has exhaled. You know, he said it was going to be a sad day when he passed. He said they'd be crying in the streets. But now we're all smiling and so joyful in his street, Miles Davis Way. I just have to tell you, when I joined Miles, the band was Herbie and Wayne and Tony. And we went up on the bandstand in San Francisco at the Both End. And we had no rehearsal. And we just started playing. And I looked over at Tony, and he looked like a big ball of smoke. And Herbie was laying out half the time, and Wayne was at the bar. And on every intermission, Miles always took me, and we went and sat down at the table, and he talked to me about cars and clothes, and he said, "I like those suits you wear."
There's almost really no room.
So after about the second night, I got enough nerve to ask Miles. I said, "What do you really want me to do?" I said, "Can I be as free as everybody else?" I said, "Tony is just going crazy." And I said, "Every now and then, I see a arrow come from the heavens and shoot right through your head and come out in the horn." I said, "What do you want me to do?" And he smiled and his eyes got bright and they glistened. And he said, "When they play fast, then you play slow. And when they play slow, you play fast. You dig?" So happy Miles Davis Day.
Buster, this is a monumental day for jazz music. How do you feel right about now celebrating the legacy of Miles Davis?
I think it's very important, and I think it's overdue, and I'm glad it's happening. Glad it's happening.
What does Miles Davis mean to jazz?
Everything. Everything, man. You know, there are certain individuals that appeared that made, their appearance made all the difference in the future. You know? Such as Louis Armstrong, you know, Coleman Hawkins, Charlie Parker, Miles Davis. If these people hadn't appeared, what transpired in their era would have never happened. I mean, these are not just great people or musicians, but they're innovators. And innovators are the ones who really shape the future. And beautiful, and fortunately enough, we have that something occurs, you know, every 20, 30, 50 years or something like that, that really sets off a new dimension. And that's the beauty about this music. There's no end to it. I just finished playing with Benny Golson, and we always open with a song that he wrote called Horizons Ahead. And that's what it really is. It's like, because of Miles, Train, Bird, they set the pace. And they influenced everybody regardless of what instrument you play. So it changed the face of the music each time these people appeared.
Buster's talking about the suits. There was a time when I was wearing a scarf all the time. And he would see the scarf on my neck, he'd say, "I'm taking that and I'm putting it around my waist." And he was so skinny, you know, he could do it at that time. And then he said something, he says, "You always got to separate the top from the bottom." Now, you know, with him, there was a lot of short little sentences that you had to decipher years later in some cases. You know, like, finish before you're done. I remember him saying that once. Finish before you're done. Okay, you know, and you never went back to question more. But there's one observation. Looking at the gentleman here, I was in the band with Al Foster in the 70s. And also, I remember at the funeral in 92, is that correct? 91 at St. Peter's. And there were a lot of us there. And looking around at that bunch of people who had played on the bandstand with Miles, 30, 40 of us, almost to the man, of course, exceptions. We played a certain way with Miles that we probably never played again. And this is a stylistic calculation, something we could be discussed, but it's very interesting because he put the voodoo on you when he chose you. And the thing about Miles that was really very heavy in a way is he completely trusted you. And that's why he didn't give you directions. He didn't have to do that. You didn't have any music, very scant with the music. He trusted the musicians. He hired you because he heard something in you that you could offer him. And then he let you do it and let you find your way. And if he said something, he'd say three words to you and you go back and figure it out. You didn't get it that night, that's for sure. So it's a great honor and it's a privilege to be up here with all these great gentlemen and to finally New York City to officially recognize. We did have a day in 98, I believe, at Birdland. I remember playing with Buster there and his family was there and they gave a plaque to the family. But this is really great and it's about time and I congratulate New York and long live Miles Davis. Yeah.
Thank you very much. It's a big honor, great honor to be here with all these great musicians. Hiring Miles Davis, my mentor, and one of the most innovative musicians in the last 200 years, I would say. And I'm glad we're getting a chance to all get together and really be able to call the street where he lived Miles Davis Way. This is perfect. So, and it's on his birthday, so this is and my birthday. The great Tony Williams, Vincent wanted me to tell you, the great Tony Williams used to call me up every year and just to ask me, Wiley, is today Miles' birthday? On my birthday. I had a lot of great times and learned a lot of great things from Miles. I got a chance to hang with him from 1983 up until the end. And I got to see all the bands since when he came back. And I got a chance to have dialogue with him while I was with Tony Williams' band. And that was a really amazing thing. We got to talk about different approaches and how to approach playing. And I remember one time I was at the Village Vanguard and Miles called me one time, Wally, what you doing? I said, I'm playing at the Village Vanguard. Come over. And at that time he was living at the Essex House. So I would come up there and he say, I told him I was playing with Tony. So he said, look, tonight, when you play with Tony, I want you to peck first. Pecking was a way of playing the phrases, but not playing in between the phrases. So he made sure I learned how to peck. And then the next night he called me and said, how did that go? I said, it was great. He said, okay. Now tonight, I want you to play something. I want you to peck, then I want you to play your phrases longer, but end them on the and a four. So he made sure I knew what that was. And I went on the bandstand and I did it with Tony. And when I finished my phrase, Tony would answer me. I said, whoa, okay, that worked. So the next day he would say, how was it? I said, it was killing. He said, okay. Now tonight when you play with him, I want you to play Tom. I want you to play my solo for Milestones. And it was funny because, I mean, he knew I loved him, but how did he know I knew his solo on Milestones? I want you to play that tonight. So I went on the bandstand and I had to think what tune I could fit that on because we was playing all Tony's originals. But Tony had one tune that was an F. So we played, it was called Arboretum, and we played Babadoo Babadada. And I said, Babadabadidee. And Tony just loved it. So Miles said, how was that? I said, man, he loves it. So he said, okay. And then this time is Friday night, and he says, I played this phrase. And he played it for me.
When I do it this way, we play it straight. If I stagger the first part, it's four. If I stagger both of them, it's drum solo.
So he showed me what to do. And I said, okay, gosh. So I got to think of what song I'm going to put this on Tony again. And I get up there, we're playing a song called City of Light. And I take my solo, and I play this phrase. And Tony goes, and he stops and looks, and the whole audience thought he was about to take a solo. He looked at me and said, Wally, don't do that. If you do that, I gotta take a solo. So the next day, Mom said, what happened? And before I get finished, he just laughed. So those are the kind of moments I have with Miles. Thank you.
Cheryl, this is a very important day for the Miles Davis legacy.
It is. It really is. Long time coming, but it's here.
Give me some fond memories of this place growing up.
Oh, my father used to come home from Europe, and he would get hugs and kisses, and he smelled like tobacco and leather. And the other fond memories are when he used to cook, and I had to go on Broadway to get the ingredients for whatever it was he was going to cook.
Today, we're seeing the world be exposed to Miles Davis' way. What is it about his legacy in this street that you want music fans and people of the culture to just appreciate about this?
That is, he's a monumental figure in music, and there's something here that lets people know that he was here on this earth in Manhattan, and he loved New York City. So that's good.
He was an innovator, and for a kid growing up in New Jersey to be able to come across the bridge or through one of the tunnels, of course the fares were only 50 cents at that time. We'll never see that day again. But what we did get to see were some of the most iconic musicians in the world. Coming into New York, you'd go to Birdland or the Blue Note, see Miles, Lee Morgan when he was emerging, Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers, the Modern Jazz Quartet. They were all coming up at that time, and what a wonderful experience for a kid from Jersey to come and see these true musicians who would set the bar so high that anybody that followed them really had a struggle to match it. Thank you all for coming out to pay tribute to Miles Davis. This will be a lasting legacy to the music and the legacy of music that he left all of us. God bless.
This is a very, very special occasion. Usually you don't see these many people getting together for something that's happy. Usually it's a funeral. So to get together for this is a very, very special thing. And for me, it's personally special because Miles Davis, I'm quite sure for mostly everybody, was a hero. And to have a monument or a street named after a hero that you know is pretty special. You know, I always aspired to be able to play with Miles Davis, and I got an opportunity to play with him and meet him. And he gave me a call to come and rehearse at his house for Bitches Group. And so, you know, anytime I passed this street, anyway, it was always Miles Davis Way to me. So the fact that they named it Miles Davis Way makes it for everybody else, actually. Because every time I passed the street, if I was with somebody, I'd say, yo, that's where Miles lives. Miles lives down that street. And, you know, I got an opportunity to, it was what, Chick Corea, Dave Holland, Jack DeJohnette, Wayne Shorter and Miles, and we rehearsed the beginning of Bitches Brew. All I had was a snare drum and a cymbal. But right over there in that building, it was a very, very special thing. It'll always be special. And thank you. Thanks, Shirley. Thank everybody who made this day possible. And now forever, not just for me, but for all of you, this is going to be Miles Davis' way.
Tell me about the first time that you met Miles and how you approached him to write the autobiography.
No, what happened was is that I had met him a couple of times previously to that, and he had dissed me. You know, he had dissed me as was his, you know, he did that if he didn't know you. And then when Spin asked me who were my top people that I wanted to write a piece on, Rudy Langlais, I told him Miles Davis, Chuck Berry, because I'm from St. Louis. Miles is from East St. Louis. And it came through like that. So that's when I really went to meet him over his house. He was living in his apartment. He was living on Central Park West. And I went over, 79th and 5th Avenue, he and Cecily. And I went in there. He made me stand up, and I had a bad knee. And I think this is what really solidified our relationship. And he finally made me, he made me stand up for about a half an hour. He was drawing. So he said, sit down over there. So I go around the table, sit down. And he looked at me and he says, how you get you? And he reaches across the table and grabbed my hair. How you get your hair like that? And I hit his hand. Bang! So he said, are you crazy? I said, no, I'm not crazy. I said, Miles's space, Quincy's space. Just because I'm here to do an interview with you, don't mean you can invade my space. So he said, where you from? I said, St. Louis. So he said, nah, I know you crazy. So then he said, well, don't just sit there, ask me a question. So I did, and then we knew each other until he died. Because we got to be really great friends. I wrote the piece on him. He thought it was the best piece ever done on him. And when it came time to do the book, he picked me. I didn't know he'd done that. And the woman, man called me up and said, Miles Davis gave you first rights of refusal to write his life story. I wasn't even thinking about it, you know? And that's how it happened. And then we got to be great friends until he died. Really great friends. My wife, my family.
What does Miles Davis mean to you?
Miles Davis means a lot to me because I loved him. He was my first cultural hero when I was 15. I grew up in St. Louis, and when I saw him play, I saw him play when I was around 16 years old. I, you know, doctored up my card to get in to see him at the club in St. Louis. And I remember that night because Sonny Rollins was supposed to come. And Spider Burks, who was the big MC, got him and said, we got some bad news. Sonny Rollins couldn't come, but John Coltrane came. And everybody said, oh, everybody was groaning, including me. You know what I mean? But it was Train play. That was the first time he played in that club. And I saw Miles that night, and I told him, but he said, you were there? I said, yeah, I was there. So that was what it was all about, you know. And then we got to be friends. I wrote the memoir on him called Miles and Me, which has been translated into many, many languages, and the autobiography. So he's a very, very special person in my heart and my wife's and family's heart, because we loved each other. So that's what it's about, and we're friends.
I've been in New York for many years, but I hail from the great state of Texas, and I was fortunate when I came to New York to really be blessed to meet a number of trumpet players. There's something about trumpet players. The brassness, the cockiness, the originality, a little bit like Texas. And in my opinion, Miles came and he fulfilled his assignment. He was authentic, his music was boundless, and he lived a fearless life. I was blessed to meet the late Lee Morgan when I became the first female on Blue Note Records. And when I met Miles, he says, oh, you're the young lady they talk about over at Blue Note. And he's like, I like you because you remind me a lot of myself. You do it your way. And I'm blessed to be here today. This is one of the most wonderful. Miles is running stuff upstairs right now. Like, I need a perfect day. And then I went on to meet the late Donald Byrd. So once again, in closing, it's just something about those trumpet players, and I'd be remiss if I didn't tell you about the first person, Lee Morgan, who took me under his wings. I love Miles Davis. Authentic, boundless, a life that was fearless.
anyway, we talked about trust earlier, that there was definitely the biggest part of it, and I cannot tell you how happy and how lucky I feel on that day, maybe 2 weeks before I played at Mikkel's. Some of you remember that. I just asked the band with whom I was playing to please find a drummer, because I felt a bit rusty playing percussion, because at that time people hire you in the instrument, they see you play once, you know. So they say, can you play percussion, you know? I say, I'm okay, brother, you're breaking my teeth with a... Anyway. So 2 weeks after, there was a gentleman sitting in the front row in Mikhail's, really paying close attention to what we were doing. And it was before the days of the internet and all those goodies, me coming from Europe. We kind of knew his face, but I could not believe Mars was right there. So I did not recognize him. How embarrassing. How embarrassing when he grabbed my arm and asked me for my phone number after the set. How embarrassing and really weird to see everybody around feel like a weird energy, and me totally being oblivious to this legend, just grabbing my hands and asking over and over for my phone number. And should I do the voice with a French accent?
Give me your phone number.
So which I did. It was at the time, it was a card that I handwritten and put scotch over it to make it look shiny. So not all French people are that classy, I guess. Long story short, because everybody is waiting to say some really, really moving words. This is memories of the first time he opened the door for me, the first time we start to jam. All the incredible gentlemen, this family, like he called us, you know, Jimmy, everybody, Larry, Dave. Incredible, incredible. Miles Way, it's in our hearts, and we are doing our best to share it with you. And thank you for coming. Thank Vince, the whole family. It's really, really a special day. With a French accent, I just said, I'm loving this day. I'm loving what's going on. Really, I'm really, really touched what's going on. Thank you all.
Tell me the first time you came to this house. And what was the first time seeing one of your heroes up close and personal outside of the music world?
Well, it was mixed feelings, because at that time my daughter was born, so the priorities were different in my life. And when you say, just come, I used to live in Jersey, just come, take a taxi, I'll pay for it, and come to the studio. The studio was here, actually. I did, I drove, because I didn't have enough money to pay the taxi to come from Jersey. And after make me visiting the whole house, he said, come on, I'll help you out with the equipment, you know. And I didn't bring anything, actually. I just wanted to come to see, because I could hardly believe what was going on, you know. And then we fetched, and I found a bass drum, I found a cymbal that I still have, because he gave it to me. And we start to jam. And that was the first of many, many, many times coming in this place. And speaking of doing things out of the music, I remember him doing some cooking and calling me. So come, you know, come. Frenchie used to call me sometimes, because he knew I appreciate good food. And, you know, he was quite a great cook as well. So we talk about paintings. And so all of this is mixed, you know, so not just music. Also things that I remember years after, the advice and protective words that he had toward me and toward some of us who were like his children, like he used to say. And all of this comes back, and I don't know if I'm answering your question, but all those emotions are coming back now, and just it's not forgotten. It's really, really a special feeling, and I'm glad you're here also to celebrate with us.
What does Miles Davis mean to you?
Well, it means someone, one of the rare person who also was able to understand me and love me unconditionally. He knew me very well and truly loved me that way, and I understood to which extent many, many years after. I still, you know, when I remember some of the things he would say or not even say, you know. That's incredible to have someone of that caliber on your corner. And when later on Cicely Tyson went further into that topic, so you know, truly, truly loved you. I realize how much now. So that's that's really, I feel very privileged when you see the list of prestigious people who are associated with him. So I'm really, really, really privileged, and you know, it's hard to, I can't find the words, you know.
Wow. It's really it's a pleasure for me to be out here today. Honesty is a very important part of jazz, and I was fortunate enough to be present when they dedicated the street to my father a mere mile down the block. But that was 30 years ago, so in the name of honesty, I have to say we're late. But it's all good.
Yes.
I had the great fortune to know Miles as a little child. I didn't start playing drums till I was almost 16 years old, so I didn't have an opportunity to play with him. And I was scared of everybody anyway at that time in my career. But I'd just like to tell you two things about Miles. Number one, when I got to be 22 years old and I used to come to the house here on the block, I had started lifting weights. And many of you know Miles was an athletic enthusiast. He absolutely adored boxing. And I came into his house about 25 pounds heavier than he'd ever seen me. And the first thing he did was he hit me with a body shot in the stomach, right? And he said, you know, you got to be ready. Everything is happening all the time, right? So did. So then I go down to the bottom line, right? It was the Electric Flag was having a reunion. It was standing room only. And I see Miles. He's like five people away from me. But I recognize him, and he recognizes me. So I say, oh, there's Miles. That's cool, but I can't get to him.
On the side.
About 2 minutes later,
over there, came a right hand to my gut.
Gotta be ready for everything.
Move
all the
over
time.
There, man.
So
we're videoing.
That, because that has a lot to do with the music. And the second thing that I want to tell you about, because we all tend to think of Miles as this enormous figure, and there's no doubt that he was, but there's an aspect of Miles that I think people often put too far to the front. And people talk about his arrogance, and people talk about, you know, how Miles would tell you to kiss his you-know-what whenever he felt like telling you to kiss his you-know-what. But I want to tell you that why Miles Davis became ultimately a great jazz musician is because he, like all of the musicians on this bandstand, understand how the concept of humility plays into the music that we play.
Well, the world may have Mozart and Beethoven, and the South may have their hillbillies, but no matter where you go all over the world, no one can take away from America can jazz. And I remember going to law school, and everyone thought I knew Miles, and I never told them any damn different. Of course, if Miles had known me, I never would have known anyway. But I think this is great for those of you that have put this affair together, and for those who are responsible for naming this street. I guess in 20, 50, 100 years, somebody may say, well, who in the hell is Miles? And we'll be able to say, why don't you go to the congressional record where Rangel has put in there who Miles was, not just for us jazz fans, but for the entire world. Whether it's Europe or Asia, Miles Davis belongs to us, but he shared his talent throughout the world. It's a blessing that we can breathe the same air, walk the same planet that he did. And because you guys are standing in the sun,
right, thank you.
I'm going to take advantage to introduce Gail Brewer. Gail Brewer is the hardest working public official that I know. I used to say for my brother Basil Patterson that I never had and heard an unkind word about him. I can't say that for Gail, because if you're wrong and you're getting away, she's going to roll right over you. But we're so proud that her councilmatic leadership has now expanded to the greatest city in the world, the greatest borough in the world, and that's Gail President Brewer.
Thank you very much, Congressman, and thank you, family and friends. I live right here in the neighborhood. was in the council for 12 years, worked for Ruth Messender when Thelonious Monk sign was put up. I was there when it was put up, and it's an honor to be here today. The one thing we need is more affordable housing so artists will be able to live in all neighborhoods in our city. So in this great tradition in Miles Davis, and what it does is it reinforces the need for all elected officials to put as much money, public money, towards the arts as possible. Thank you very much, and congratulations to everybody.
I am Easy Mo B. I produce Miles Davis' last effort. It was entitled Dubop. It was a hybrid between jazz and hip hop. And Miles had, he had went through the transition of every phase of music that he could make. From early on with The Birth of the Cool to albums like Kind of Blue, Sketches of Spain, much later in the 80s, albums like Tutu, but he had never ever dabbled with hip hop. And that's what our collaboration was all about. In 1992, we won a Grammy for Best R&B Vocal, R&B Instrumental Performance. And I just wanted to say that I'm very glad to be a part of the legacy and the heritage of Miles Davis. The fact that now we have a street, a strip of a street that's renamed after him, Miles Davis Way. I knew him at another time when he stayed on Central Park West between 88, 89, went to the house. It was kind of like an audition, me and a bunch of others. Everybody played their stuff, and I was gonna play mine. Whatever reason, they saved me for last. So I finally, I played my stuff, and they all left, and then he turned to me and he said, I like you. I want to work with you. You heard some stuff that I had submitted on a reel from, believe it or not, the genius from Wu-Tang got me the gig with Miles Davis. He heard a track that I had did with the genius, and he said, would you do that for me? Would you do that? So, the track is called True Fresh MC. That's what got me the gig with Miles Davis. I'm thankful to be a part of his heritage, and I'm glad that as he transitioned through all the different stops of music, he made sure right before the end that he made a stand with hip hop. And I'm glad to say that I'm a part of that.
Thank you, Moby.
Happy 88th birthday to Miles Davis. Congratulations, Miles Davis Way.
First of all, let me just say thank you for standing out here in the hot sun for the last 2 hours. When Miles Davis passed away, I received a number of telephone calls, one of which was from my teacher. And she said to me, do you think he realized how much he was loved? I said, I don't think so. Well, today is evidence of how much he was and is still loved. Thank you all for being here. I know the one thing that you might have asked is, why did it take you all so long? This is Miles Davis Way. It's always been Miles Davis Way. Y'all just didn't know. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Here we go, guys. Look in this way for me, please.
Miles Davis walks right off.
Thank you.
One more, one more, one more, one quick shot, one, two.